I'll be happy this week, man, if we come away with if the sound was fantastic, right, and finally it clicks and bang, that is it.
Yeah.
That we get to come over a single or a couple of potential singles and a B-side, and then also maybe just some backing tracks or something. Do you know what I mean?
All the mics we've got up in the barn at the minute are open and up.
Right.
So that's right, we need to start now. Right, that's where we're at. Start putting it back.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it sounds good at the moment, but it's got to sound fucking great. That's what we're looking for. Everything you ever do, it always builds up to something, you know. But for me, it's just like really fresh. I just think, I mean, from the floorboards up alone, it's just sort of fresh. It's just like, bang, you know, this is it. This is a new statement. This is where I'm at now, and away we go, you know, as is now, you know, that's the statement.
Paul said to me when we were driving across on a bus to Belgium last year, I want to make a record that just sounds like one piece. It just sounds like one continual piece.
Just buzzing again off playing live, you know, which I nearly always do, but even this time is even more. I just think we're getting better as a band as well. I really do. However old I get, I just think it's all getting better to me, you know. And I just thought, you know what, the kind of sort of songs we need as a live working unit. And we need a bit more rock and roll back in there, you know. Because it's all got a bit mid-tempo in the last sort of few albums, a bit soft. And so I guess it was kind of geared towards that, not so much towards what I think my audience will like, even though, you know, kind of that is a consideration, obviously, but more what's going to work live as well, you know.
Best time to get a band in is after they've played 30 shows in 30 days, or, you know, or 30 shows in 40 days. And, you know, vocally sometimes it's not the best idea, but for backing tracks and for the band, it's without a doubt, you know, they've all been together, they're all playing together every night. So, and you can hear it, I mean, you totally can hear it. That's what I started with, the way we were going to make the record. I wanted to start in a classic, you know, an old school manner, but that would lead to great things.
I mean, I never thought I'd ever get this far in life, to be honest with you. I mean, I'd have been happy just to make the first single, you know, when I was 17, when I was 18 or whatever, and, you know, someone said, oh, that's your lot, and I've just been quite happy to be honest, do you know what I mean? And just gone back to playing little clubs in Woking, I suppose. But, I mean, I'm glad, you know, I'm glad to have got this far.
You could sit back and rest on your laurels. He could do, you know, he could pull out all the old stuff and just make a big old greatest hits thing, and we could be the Rolling Stones or whatever. It's not enough for Paul.
You know, something completely different. After Illumination, which was my last studio album, last album that I wrote anyway, a few years ago, whatever it was, two or three years ago, I didn't write anything for a good sort of year and a half, you know, and I wasn't particularly upset by it either. I was just really had enough of it. I just kind of was bored with writing. And that's why I did the covers album. It was just like a nice release and a nice break away from writing and the pressures of writing an album. I would have kind of been happy to have not written again, you know, that's how I kind of felt anyway. Not every record's worked out, obviously, and well, I've made a couple of turkeys here and there, I guess, you know what I mean, if I'm really honest. But I would say, I would never consciously put a record out that was rubbish or, you know, substandard. I mean, and I wouldn't consciously play a gig that was substandard. I always try and do my hardest, and I don't know if that comes through to people. I don't know.
That's a long time. You've got to have a come down off something like Stanley Road, ultimately. And albums like Heliocentric, Heavy Soul, and Illumination, there's really good moments on them, but I think that ultimately when you go into the arena of having a successful album like Standing Road was, I think there's got to be a downside to it, you know.
For those two, 3 years, it weren't happening, you know, for him. And he was the first mate. It's not happening. I'm not feeling it. Feel alive, been sleeping. might have looked, but I've never. And I never really had a problem with that, because I was always like, well, you know, one third of your ability as a musician is your songwriting, then there's your guitar playing, and there's your singing as well. So kind of, I see you in sort of three different lights. You say, and it must be so fucking tough for him. Such a long time to be waiting in the sun.
But as fate or whatever, luck or whatever has it, you know, the kind of songs you said came to me, really. And I just feel I was just kind of like a little bit of a conduit for a lot of the tunes. I just kind of just sat down and wrote them down, you know.
He'll come in one day, and he just was at home last night watching the telly, but I kind of did this, and he'll play you a tune, and you go, hey, where's that come from? I don't know. I don't question it. I mean, he just kind of cracks on with it. I just have nothing but respect for the man. It's the start. It's a long time.
Such a long time. To be waiting in the sun.
It sounds a bit clicky in here, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Not, I mean, it doesn't probably, it's just in the cans. I can only hear the.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I'll do a bit of work on that.
Okay. We should do another one, man.
Music's universal, isn't it? Yeah. Music's one thing that cuts across any bullshit and cuts across any boundaries and cultural barriers, I'd say, really. And, you know, it really is a universal language, isn't it? And I think, you know, that's what always connects with people. That's why we're digging about African music or Indian music or music from Brazil, sitting in Woking in Surrey, digging Otis Redding, you know what I mean? It's not. It is a cultural thing in the sense that it's kind of, that it unifies us, I think, you know. And it's the sound of the earth as well, I think, especially in a lot of folk music.
I don't know if that's the root.
To me, the sound of the barn's coming through. There's a real toughness and the decay and stuff.
Yeah.
You're getting on that on the cymbals.
Yeah, just need to warm it up a little bit.
I would still be happier if we had, that's the fucking drum sound, and that is it.
Yeah. I just think it's four blokes just getting on with it, you know, and we're all sort of, as I say, we're all kind of dealing with the trials and tribulations of life, and we're not kind of in our ivory towers. There's lots of musicians get to that point and cover themselves in fucking memberships of shit clubs. We're just sort of still really massively intrigued by the process. We're still massively influenced by great musicians. And we're trying to aspire to something that keeps us all going. I don't think it's any more simple than that. I don't care if people don't get it, we get it.
All right, guys.
I don't care if people don't get it, we get it.
All right, guys.
I love you.
Well, I think that there's quite a few songs that have turned up on the album that started out, I guess, as B-sides. I think I Want to Make It All Right was going to be a B-side. Savages was going to be a B-side. And I read the lyric form to Savages, and I just thought it was such an amazing lyric. And Blink, I think Blink was going to be a B-side track as well. So there's quite a few tracks that were going to be B-sides, but it kind of, when we record them, listen to them back, and it kind of just shone quickly.
I think with this record, I think we really wanted to enjoy it. I think we did. And, you know, I think as an experience, it's kind of up there with Café Bleu, Stanley Rowe, and this record.
Have a listen, yeah? Sure, y'all?
I had Chopper Low. So I said, I was listening mainly to drums, bass and your guitar.
Right.
And it's tighter. Yeah, you're right. Better place.
Folk was in here.
Folk was in
here? I mean, I don't know. What do you want?
I want to do it over here.
Right, come on then. Let's have it. Can't nobody love you like I love you, yeah. Can't nobody lead you like I lead you, yeah. While you got your head in the clouds and talking so loud, can't you see past the stages?
You know, he's not the Strokes, man. He's not Razor Light. He's not, you know, he's not trying to break any sort of grounds, or he's not trying to be trendy. He's trying to be him. And it's almost a struggle being him enough that when he feels inspired, you know, he feels it, man. It's a feeling. There's so many feelings on this record.
Blink, and it just might miss me. Yeah, it's all right.
Cool. I love Roll Along Summer because I actually think that me and Paul spent a lot of time as two guys talking about jazz and talking about the relationship between particular, and it's going to sound really pretentious, but like talking about like John Coltrane and Elvin Jones, and I think that the whole kind of meter, the 3-4 meter against Paul's vocal is quite Coltrane-ish, and I really love that.
We had 2 days of chasing the sound, and as soon as you've got the sound and the band hear it in the headphones and we hear it in the studio, then it's just hit record, let them go, and then just keep going and going and going. I think your big rock records with, you know, thunderous bass, throwing your kitchen sink in there, double tracking everything, your tambourines, and more. And it's not, I don't think that's now. I think we are in the middle of a new decade, you know. We've had a new millennium, but we are, you know, we're in the middle of, there's a new lean sound out there, for me, without a doubt.
We just go for performances, you know, that's the thing with us, because, I mean, which has never changed, I mean, all the years we've been doing it, really, it's always been about that, pretty much, anyway. Might be a slight sort of deviation back in the sort of Style Council, digital, fucking sequence days, but, I mean, apart from that, it's always been sort of live takes, really. And the great thing about recording like that is that once you've done a take, you kind of either know it's in the pocket, or it isn't, or you've got to go back and do it again, you know, there isn't no... We'll dress it up later on, or we'll tie it up later. It's either there or not, you know.
Felt good, that. Yeah, let's have a listen. Fuck you, bastard.
That's the one, wasn't it?
Fucking number one in Japan, that'll be.
We all kind of respect the tune, respect what he's doing enough to sort of like be honest and go like, well, what? You know, this is what we think. And he might go, no, that's, you know, I think you should, or no, you're right. You know, or I might come up with a drum beat and it goes, well, I don't think that works. But it's no problem.
Well, unless you want to throw a vocal on that, that's how it is. That is magic.
Okay. I think the words are so strong on this album. I think that, you know, some of the melodies are so strong that if we can't get it from what we've got naturally, then we're not really interested in chasing anything. It's either, you know, magic or it's not. Shine on! Shine on everyone.
know, maybe some people, I think I just sit and listen to the Small Faces all day, do you know what I mean? Which is probably, yeah, I mean, I try to listen for half the day anyway, you know what I mean? Only in the morning, so. But, I mean, I listen to all sorts of music, I really, you know what I mean? I don't want to sound sort of trendy, but I mean, I just love music, and if it's good, it's good to me. I mean, it's a subjective thing, that, obviously. But if I like it, and I feel it's got something to give me, then I'm into it, whether it's country and western or classical, whatever, don't mind, really. Literally in the space of like a week or two, I wrote Roll Along Summer, Here's the Good News, Golden Leaves, Bring Back the Funk, Oranges and Rosewater, which is a B-side now. They just seem to be flowing, you know, and I didn't have, it's not always nice to when you're writing, that you don't, that it's not interrupted, you know. Blackface took an empty dive. I only want what I know is mine. Sound the bell, cause here's the good. Sometimes it's like with Roll On Summer, I just wrote the words out one night and then got the tune the next day. And then other times I'd be playing the guitar and then words would just appear, and that would kind of make the, you know, that's the foundation of the song, and you just build on that. But then other times it's kind of me just sort of just sitting down and just kind of aimlessly and not and unselfconsciously just playing, you know, and then something sort of comes together. It's like, oh, that's something nice. And then you just, you know, you just find the rest of it, really.
You know, we were in the studio for 2 days and we didn't put anything down because of, you know, technical reasons, but we still did like the most amazing demos you've ever heard, the tightest demos, especially of floorboards. I mean, that we had a great, we might have had it. And then again, we had that, we listened to it in the morning and then we went again. So we went for better and better and better. So they were all little bits of inspiration that have sort of, for me, have fallen into place, really.
Paul's mugness, it's Paul's lifestyle.
So they were all little bits of inspiration that have sort of, for me, have fallen into place, really.
Paul's mugness, it's Paul's lifestyle. And it'd be wrong for me to try to put it down to anything. Do you know what I mean? I've already been thrown out of Solid Bond once. I don't want to get thrown out of the fucking band again. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Well, I went down as a 16-year-old kid, sort of knocking on the door.
In the boys, is it?
You did that first time, didn't
you? Yeah. But, you know, it's just Paul, it's Paul's quality as a, you know, it leads us all there as followers, you know. It's kind of, that's where the whole modernism thing, we all kind of follow it. If we, same as goths and same as Teddy Boys and all, you know, I guess, pick whatever genre you want to. But he's definitely a leader. And I think his singing's got so much better. I think that even though at times he tries to profess that he's thick and hard, he's poet L'Oreal at the same time. I got a feeling from the floorboards up. Call it to call it if you like that touch. Call it what you will, I really don't care too much. I
central song for me will have to be Floorboards, you know, from the Floorboards up, because I just think it's... as soon as I sort of hear it, I want to sort of smash my kitchen up, you know, which I don't do, do you know what I mean, obviously. But it's got that sort of, I don't know, that kickstart thing about it, man, you know, in the nicest possible sense, you know what I mean? Lovely to hear a four, you know, four-piece band, real simple, 2:27, very direct, and just a little niggly in there, you know, a little in there. It's nice to hear that again.
There was one solo I had to do. I think it was Floorboards. When I had to, he did a lead guitar, and he said, "Well, you go and do one and see what's best." And I went in there purposely and I thought, I'd rather try and play something more psychedelic or something more hidden, really.
We had like 2 months where, I'd like to say, I think we had sort of 9 or 10 for the album. We had 7 of them down, and he went away, and he got off on it so much that he came back with like 11, you know, top tunes, man.
We did about 8 songs first, and there's some really good numbers in them, like Roll Along Summer. But it was when Paul started coming up with Floorboards, Come On, Let's Go, sort of, and Paper Smile, all kind of happened around the same sort of time, even though we'd already done like about 8 songs, so aren't these new ones possibly even better? So it's like, well, there's going to be a fantastic record here. You have never been there till you find the fact of saying
that nothing else matters, everything just pales within. I went around to his house and he played me the demo of Come On, Let's Go, and as soon as I heard that acoustic demo, I thought it was just a brilliant song straight away, you know what I mean? Sing, you little fuckers, sing like you've got no choice. I believe it's true. We are everywhere. And I feel the wind. And it feels so high. There is no purpose, definitely is no need. Go running round the houses like a racehorse of speed.
It's got a beautiful message that's kind of slightly ambivalent. It's about, look, take my hand and let's see where we go. And I guess that's where we're kind of all at as blokes.
Well, because I mean, the lyrics are like, you know, you say where to, and I say, I don't know. I have no idea, but let's just go, you know. I made some pretentious statement the other week, which was really cool, you know, about God's invisible scooter, you know, and get on the fucking invisible SX200 and let's fucking go, you know. Don't know where it is, you know, somewhere good, somewhere up in the clouds, man. I just know we've got to do one. Baby, let's go. Ooh, come on. Baby, let's go. Did you see? I mean, I said to my daughter, bless her heart, she's only 13, man. And we went to see Kings of Leon last night. And she was saying to me on the way back home about how fantastic music is, you know, and how it unites people. And it's true, it's just this fucking holy communion of rock and roll. It's true, you know. It's the only thing I can personally think of on earth that really unites everyone, you know, in a universal way as well. And it's just great to get that vibe back again, isn't it? You know, we all go off the board a bit sometimes and get cynical, but when you do get back on it, you realise how fucking great it is, how much you missed it, you know. And definitely all these little bands come up, whether I like the music or not, they're out there doing it and playing live, and I think that's so, you know, so fucking important. I mean, it just brings a whole new energy and lifeblood to music, you know. And you know, no matter how old you are and how many records you've done and what you've done and all that crap, you know, you need that kick up the arse every now and again, you know.
And even up to like a week before we started rehearsing for the last part of the album, I was still writing tunes then. I mean, I wrote probably like four or five in like the last week before we started recording, you know. And a lot of them were going to be like, well, just, you know, we need a couple of B-sides, so I just, you know, just bang a couple of B-sides out, which would turn the corner and become something else again, you know. So it was kind of, it's just nice to feel that creative and productive again, you know. I do think we need to bring back the funk, you know. I don't think it's just down to us white boys from fucking Surrey to bring it back, but I just think generally in the world we need to bring back the funk, you know. But I guess you're sort of making the funk, you know, something bigger than what it is, you know, bigger than the musical genre, just, you know, when we talk about God or love or fun or family, I don't know. I'm sort of using it in that sense, really, sort of bring back the, you know, something we can all grab hold of and be part of.
So I'm dedicated to all our brothers and sisters lost their lives last week in the bombing. Something called Savages.
I mean, I was specifically thinking about, you know, that thing that happened in the school in Russia, where, you know, where kids had, where the bomb's gone off and the army's stormed in and the kids are running out into the playground to their parents and they're still shooting them in the back. It's just like, how can you fucking do that, man? And this, you know, in 2005, it's still going on. You know, whether that will always go on, I don't know, but it's not good enough, really, is it? You know, I don't know how we change that, I don't know. And that's why I'm not making any, that's what I said, I'm not making any sort of grand statement, but I just know that it's wrong. We should all know it's wrong, that's what it's saying. You just don't do that to your brothers and sisters, you know, let alone to fucking kids, man. That's, you know, it's a basic statement, really.
I speak to people all over the country about Paul's songs as fans, and it's like they all talk about what the lyric means, you know. That's when it identifies with them like that.
They all come out of your subconscious a lot of time. Doesn't always necessarily mean they're, you know, autobiographical, but I mean, I think they all come from the same sort of place, really. And I think more than anything, you know, it's just trying to spread a bit of love around, you know. And to try and make people feel good about things and believe again, you know, and get people back on board, you know. It's a pop record, I know, you know, and it's, you know, I'm not fucking Bono or anything, I don't want to be, man, but I'm making my own little personal statement, you know. And hopefully people will dig it and get on with it and come on with us, you know.
I think a lot of it as well is that Paul's so passionate about, you know, what he thinks about his music, that when you can see him getting off of it, you know, it just transcends to you, you know.
That's the thing. If you still have this love of what you do, then it will come through regardless, you know. And I think Weller still has that love, that passion that he's always had from when he was 16 until now when he's 47.
I think the scary thing is how quickly it's gone. You know, we're all, you know, I was 18 when I first started working with Paul. It was his 25th birthday.
We have worked together for a long time, but I mean, I think this is probably some of our best playing, you know. I don't know what's happened, really. I think we all just sort of stepped up a bit, you know, and it just seems to get better every year. I mean, I don't know if it's going to stop at some point in time, whether it'll go on forever, I don't know, really. I mean, but we just seem to talk less about things, but naturally just all seem to sort of do them, you know, do the right thing and play the right things. And
Damon's the baby, 10 years. Steve's 12 years, I think. I'm 22 years. So, you know, I think, you know, I think it might have something to do with it. But I think I more and more think it's how we kind of deal with each other as people. I really do. It's a dynamic.
So at the end of the day, when, you know, one person sort of raises a voice or a fist, it kind of means nothing. When two do it, people begin to listen. When four do it, it's because it's a group of people that are kind of following a similar mantra, a similar path. And probably, you know, none of us really know what's going to happen once that gig's finished.
I mean, obviously playing live, I mean, you know, I mean, most of the time you spent, out of your 24 hours in a day, you're just waiting for those 2 hours where you're on stage. I am anyway. And the rest of the time it's just sort of hanging about, really. And, but I do think there is a kind of, you know, there is that kind of romantic thing about being on the road and going to different places and travelling on and moving on all the time, you know, and it's kind of like a constant sort of, constantly changing. There's a little thing I always get, you know, when I'm sort of late at night after a gig, going down a motorway, which aren't exactly the most romantic of places, but going down at night time and just seeing that big row of lights and the white line in front of you, and you're just travelling on. And I don't, you know, I mean, I suppose it's because it's what I've always done as well. It's all I've ever known, but it's kind of, but it still kind of excites me, that it still sort of fills me with a sense of sort of wonder in a way, you know.
I went away and I had the roughs, and I was sitting playing it to a friend of mine at her house, and it really dawned on me that it was a great record. We really had a great record on our hands. You know, I've really felt it that weekend. And then I just watched other people really, it started dawning on people sort of on the Wednesday and Thursday of that week, which, you know, ended up in a massive party. But, you know, it was right at the time. What's in a life if you don't live it?
I think also what we're hearing and what we're doing is inspiring that as well. Because I've worked on other albums where we don't stay up till 3 a.m. listening back to what we've done in the daytime, you know. We're quite happy to sort of go to bed, you know what I mean? So I think that's always a good sign. I mean, everyone's on the lash maybe, but that doesn't matter about that. It's, you know, what's better than hearing loud music and getting the best, you know what I mean? Answers on the postcard, man, you know what I mean? But it'd only be any good if what you're hearing is good, wouldn't it, you know? It'd be a false empty, you know, thing otherwise. I mean, Stevie Craddock, I mean, he's playing amazing on this record, I think, you know, proper lead guitarist, and I was quite happy just to be the rhythm guitarist and the singer, you know. And Damon's playing, I mean, everything, you know, it's just right, it's also right. Great parts and great individual parts, but it works as a body, as a unity as well.
Not me today, but come on.
Let's go.
Drop in, man. Let's have it.
Right, should we move on then?
Day one.
Day one. I'm halfway through, man. I'm still there.
I'm halfway through my life, if I'm lucky.
I'm halfway through this album, if I'm lucky. It's exciting, isn't it?
We'll be whispering it in an invisible bird's ear. It's like, get on the invisible fucking SX200 and let's fucking go. Do you know what I mean? God's invisible scooter.
Let's fucking do one. Album sale! Album sale! Write that down, man!
Do one, man. You know
there's bands out there fucking dying for these fucking titles. God's invisible scooter!
They need to get out more, man.
You've just got to fill in the X's.
So, well, we've got two done anyway.
Yeah, always positive, man. We've got two.
I think it's a nice city to come to if you've got to be mixing at all, and because you can walk outside here and walk around and it's lovely, and the bars are nice and we know people here and we've got friends here now. But no, I don't think it's essential to it. I think what is essential is that little fella sitting in there, the Dutch engineer fella, Yuri, because he's kind of, it's his ears and his expertise that's kind of getting the sound
technically, he's very talented as an engineer, and the patience he has is magical. I love you. Will you marry me?
Should it be like that?
No, it should be clever. It's like George Harrison.
Yeah.
It is, I think it's amazing if you see that, you know, almost all the tracks is just one take and how tight it is. And there's no editing going on, and there's no looping or stuff like that, no digital wonders in there. I love this.
Yeah, it sounds awesome.
Very good.
Well, I don't know, I mean, it could be me saying to my kids, you know, fly, forever fly, you know, I mean, be free and don't let people tie you down and just, you know, but then it becomes something else again. I don't know. I don't even want to put my finger on some of these tunes, you know, because you've done all the time down, you know. It's like a little balloon you let go into the sky and, you know, and off you go, and wherever it lands, you know, who knows, but it's enough sometimes, you know, there's too much tying down in this world, you know.
Because yeah. On the last, just the last vocal line, I think.
No, don't even recall it, but do it again.
Nah, I think it's all there, mate. Mm. It's there. That'd be the only thing for me, just yeah. But apart from that, it's fucking mega.
I mean, I do think it's special, I really do. And I kind of know it is in a way. Do you know what I mean? About being arrogant, but I do sort of, I know it is. But where it sits in the whole sort of scheme of things, I don't know at the moment. I'd know that after a few months, I suppose, and see how it stands the test of time and that, you know. I get to feel it from the floor goes up. Call it to call it if you like that touch. Call it what you will, I really don't care too much.
I'd say a mate of mine, Simon, when I say when he listened to it, he summed it up beautifully. He said it was two camps, which I thought was hilarious, man. Now, I've never heard anybody turn around and say an album's two camps before. But, it is, it's two shades, man. There's, you know, you've got upbeat, rocking numbers, and you've got some of the most beautiful songs you've ever heard.
I'm just hearing it now back for the first time. Songs like Paper Smile and The Pebble and the Boy. And Bring Back the Funk, I thought. And also Pan that Paul does. In fact, the two songs on Paul's own, Pebble and the Boy and Pan, sounded extraordinary. Can you tell the difference between the pebble and the boy? Far away in the distance, the sun in your eyes. Can you see the footprints that have merged with the sand?
You know, when you're in a great environment with, you know, like the people that you love, and you're doing these songs, you know, we were sort of, you know, you were there, man. You know what I mean? We were like eight brothers, just trying to do the best for each other. But I do, I think you can feel it, I really do believe it. You can feel it and hear it, and it's, you know, it starts with Paul downwards, really. You know, it's his songs, it's his guitar and his voice, and he's at home writing, and then it's, you know, it falls down the ladder, really, and then we all get our inspiration from there. With, you know, you, like the people that you love, and you're doing these songs, you know, we were sort of, you know, you were there, man, you know what I mean? We were like eight brothers, just trying to do the best for each other. But I do, I think you can feel it, I really do believe it. You can feel it and hear it, and it's, you know, it starts with Paul downwards, really. You know, it's his songs, it's his guitar and his voice, and he's at home writing, and then it's, you know, it falls down the ladder, really, and then we all get our inspiration from there.
Still such a fan, it's sort of sometimes embarrassing, you know. But, I can't distance myself away from that. I'd recently called me a stalker. He says, he's a right little fucking stalker. But as fans, as you are, right, I'm sure that, you know, we want to hear Paul's original songs, don't we?
it's definitely one of the best things I've done in recent years, in the last 10 years, that's for sure. For me anyway, me personally, you know. Where it puts me now, I've no idea, you know, just how I feel about it, but it's just, I just feel good about it. I just think, you know, I've done something good here. And the band has, and everyone has worked on it, you know. And I suppose it's kind of, you know, not gratifying is the right word, but after all these years, after all these records, to still feel like that, I'm like, fucking hell, wow. You know what I mean? It's like, that's something else, really. And I'm grateful for it as well, I think, just to feel that inspired again after sort of, you know, 30 years or whatever the fuck it's been. Can you see the future? With each step you take, yet you feel you're no further in your walking away. Can you tell the difference between the pebble and the man? Far away in the ocean, when it's back on dry sand. I think that Paul will go down as one of the greatest musicians this country's ever produced. I really simply do. And I love working with him. I love the fight. I love the struggle. I like getting out there and proving ourselves. Because we're not 27. We're not 37. We're where we are at. And it's, you know, it's not a bad place to be.
Thank you very much. Good night. Peace. God bless you.
You've never been there till you find the fuck out sing. Then nothing else matters, everything just pales within. Hanging on the corners, shouting at the top of your voice. Sing you little fuckers, sing like you got no choice. I believe it's true. We are everywhere. And I feel the wind, and it feels so high. There is no purpose, definitely is no need. Start running round the houses like a race horse of speed. I believe again, we are everything. And I feel the wind, and it gets so high. Come on, baby, let's go. I just need to run.